in just a second. There we go. So welcome everyone, Teaching Math to Spatial Learners, I believe is the title. Did I get that right, or is it for spatial? Okay, awesome. I'm looking forward to this, Faith. My name is Sean Williams. I'm gonna be the moderator. So if you have any questions at all, feel free to drop them in the chat. And if I can't help you with that, I'll try and interrupt Faith at a good time. Say, hey, there's a couple of questions in the chat, so, but you don't have to worry about it, Faith. Just do your thing and I'll be in the background and let's do this.
Okay, thanks very much. All right, I will welcome here. It would be nice to come to Quebec. I have an uncle who lives there, so it would be nice to be there in person, but it's also really a nice way to balance work and life, to be able to do this and just go home at the end of the day instead of worrying about traveling back home again. Okay, share. For some reason, it's not letting me share my screen. Just a sec. Just 1 minute.
You're good.
Are you seeing it?
Not yet.
Okay.
So when you click the present button, you have the choice of your entire screen, a window, or a tab. Are you seeing that?
Yep. Okay. So here. Are you seeing it now?
Yes, we're seeing your PowerPoint, Math for Spatial Learners.
Yep.
Awesome.
Okay, here we go. So who am I? I'm a mother to two adult children. I have dogs who are very important to me. If you look at my Instagram, you will see marvelous things that my dog can do. I have a Bachelor of Music. I speak several languages. English was the fourth language I learned fluently, and French was my fifth, and I work entirely in French now. Both of my parents studied math in university and provided me with a math-rich environment as a child. While working on my music degree, I enjoyed music theory the most, and that is the math of music. I taught music for many years, and I switched to teaching in the classroom 10 years ago. I'm currently enrolled in math classes at the University of Manitoba, in addition to teaching a grade 4-5 classroom half-time, and I am in the process of applying for my Master's of Education in Math Curriculum. So the first year that I taught classroom math, Sarah Malot was our resource teacher. At the time, she was working on her Master's in Math Education, which she has since completed, and here's a link to her website. Sarah is also presenting at QPAD as well. Sarah helped me reframe teaching math. You kind of have this idea that students are good at math or bad at math, but it's rather that we need to try different approaches for different students to meet their needs. It was about 5 years ago in 2017 that I really started working on how I wanted to, or how to improve my methods of teaching math so that my students could succeed. In 2019, I participated in the SWIM program, and that was really a change, really changed my perspective on how I should be teaching math in grade 4 and 5. So who is a spatial learner? One of my friends who took the workshop with me last year pointed out that while I'm speaking about spatial learners today, this is really relevant to all learners. The methods I teach are geared to a spatial learner, but all learners will benefit from having a new perspective on math, or having it approached from a different point of view. So this article has really been foundational to my teaching. It's very short. And it has a lot of information in it. It's really helped me understand certain students I have taught over the years. So sequential learners use words to explain what they know. They have logical sequences. A lot of elementary school teachers teach sequentially. So we start with, 3+1, 4+1, 5+1, and then we move to 3+2, 4+2, 5+2. So those are sort of logical sequence of building building up skills, and that works well for sequential learners. However, spatial learners have complex ideas. They like to make things, often in multiple dimensions. They solve problems in unusual ways. I really celebrate it when a student in my class comes up with an idea that I have never heard from a student before. They make connections that are not obvious and leap to conclusions, often skipping many steps, and they are inventors and are composers. On the downside, they can be very easily distracted. They do not appear to listen in class. They might be kind of thinking their own thoughts. They may lack executive functioning skills, having trouble putting things in a logical order to do them in that order that you are asking them to do. They may have a hard time explaining what they know. They're not always rational. And they often have difficulty telling time. They might be able to tell time on the clock, but they don't have a sense of passing time. So I know of a couple of spatial learners who learned the order of the months of the year in high school or even after high school because it just putting things in order didn't make sense to them. So sequential learners start with the parts and build up to more complex ideas. Spatial learners start with the whole and then move down to the parts. Duke University has a program for gifted learners. And what they found was, what they were trying to do is find students in grades 7 and 8 and then follow them through and see what success they had later on. And they're kind of trying to find the people who will win Nobel Prizes and that sort of thing. And so there were a few people who did not qualify for their program, who applied and didn't qualify for the program, who went on to have great success. And what they found was that these students may not have shown a lot of success early in life, but they were highly, highly spatial thinkers. And those are the people who go on to discover new things. So for spatial learners, I have a number of slides here that talk about lagging skills, and I have links to helpful information or information that has been helpful to me in my teaching. So this podcast talks about how we can reframe our thought process about a student's skills. So it's not us managing their behavior to us, it's not so much us managing their behavior as giving them the skills to grow themselves and meeting their needs. Comic strip conversations have been very helpful for my students. The fact that people say one thing and maybe thinking something else. So you draw little stick people and someone says, I don't like you. And then, but they might be thinking something completely different, or like they might be thinking, I just need some time alone, or I'm having a really hard day, something else. So the fact that people don't always say what they're thinking can really change a student's perspective. Richard Green's ALSUP is a great way to work with a student to identify lagging skills and make a plan. So you're working together on this plan. I use nonviolent communication quite a bit in my classroom. And again, it's been really eye-opening for my students who are not considered neurotypical to realize that, for instance, they might need a completely quiet classroom to succeed, but someone else might work better in a noisy classroom. And then for those who function well in a noisy environment, it's really interesting really eye-opening for them to see that other students need quiet to succeed. Oh, sorry, there's going to be a little announcement now. Oh, sorry, that's my bell at school. So I have used nonviolent communication a fair amount, just about helping students communicate what their needs are with their peers and with me. And this is Mr. Barton's math podcast, which is mostly geared to junior high and high school topics. But this particular episode was very interesting in discussing all the different types of skills you need before you can succeed in problem solving. It is in middle school that many students begin to develop their spatial skills. Teaching math with spatial learners in mind will also help sequential learners develop their spatial reasoning skills. Okay, so for all the basic operations, we want to start from the whole and then break it into parts. So I will describe how I work in this way in my classroom. A note at this point is, in previous years, a lot of the approach to math was kind of one and done. You cover addition, you give the test, the kid gets a mark on the test, and that's what they did in addition. And then you move on to the next topic. So for me, I do all four operations all year long with my grade fours and fives. And if they cannot add to 10, I stay with adding to 10 all year if I need to, because if I move them on to more complex addition, if they don't have those basic skills, I'm really doing a disservice to the student and to the teachers in future years. So we stay with what they need to work on. Of course, I make that really interesting and we do a variety of activities, but their basic work is at the level they are at in order to build a strong foundation for the future. So I have number cards, 1 to 10, and they use them to pair them up. Now I'm going to exit this and go back to, I'm going to switch my screen now, or my camera. Okay, so these are my cards to 10. It's a little, you can't quite see all of them, but I have the numbers from 1 to 10 and I have 2 fives. So at the beginning of the year, I give students these cards and I ask them to make the partners to 10, whatever the partners are to 10. So they have 10 and they have 8 and 2 and they have 3 and 7 and so on. So they're pairing them up. And then we see how quickly they can do that. Now my students will very quickly start putting them in order from 1 to 10, and then they'll quickly lay them out and they see the pattern that you can just go down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then 5, and then you can go back up. So you can use a pattern to do it really quickly. Once they start doing that, I say, oh, you need to mix up your cards. You need to mix them up first and then partner them up. It's great to have them in order, but you should be able to see that 8 and 2 are partners automatically. You shouldn't have to arrange them in the right order to figure out what the partners are. And we work on this as long as they need to work on it. Some years, this is 5 minutes at the beginning of my math class, or even 2 minutes once I get quick at it. So some years I will be doing this for a week. Other years I'll be doing it for a couple of weeks to maybe a month and a half. This year my students got through this, I think it was within 2 or 3 days, and then we moved on to the next level. So the next level are partners to 20. I will write numbers, well, before I get to 20, well, I'll say like partners to 7. So then they'll do their partners to 7 or to 8, whatever number it is, and we'll use these. And they quickly realize that when we have an even number, they need something else. So that's when I introduce the times 2. So if you have if you're adding to an even number, you can use times 2, and then you don't need the 2 fives anymore. You can take one of the fives away because you have your solution of 5 times 2 equals 10. So once the numbers 210 addition 210 is firmly established and the students have developed an automaticity with that, then I move on to 20. So I'll give them a number and they have to rearrange the cards to that number. Again, if I notice someone is putting them in order, I will remind them to mix the cards up and just automatically know what are the partners to this number. I do have a student, I have several students with IEPs, and when they are working, I will allow them things like arranging them in order until they have more confidence with it, and then they can mix them up. Last year, I had a student with an IEP who I would hand out counters. So I'd just put a number of counters on their desk, and then they would count how many there were, and then that was the number they had to add to, and they moved the counters around to help find the partners. So we did that all last year, and because it's a 4-5 classroom, I often have students for 2 years in a row. And this year, that student is able to do all the partners to 20 without any additional help. They're doing it completely independently, and their actual IEP goal for grade 4 was to add to 10, and their IEP goal for grade, or to add to 10 like with assistance, and their IEP goal for grade 5 was to do subtraction facts to 10 with assistance. So at this point, they are doing partners to 20, to 10 and to 20 without any help. So they're already far exceeding what their learning goals were based on the psychology, this educational psychological report that they received.
Hey, Faith?
Yes.
I'm sorry. We're looking at the Meet screen, and I think you're trying to present your document camera.
I am trying to do that. Thank you very much.
Sorry about that.
Switch cameras. Nope, not that. Oh, you know what? I think I need to pin it, right? I think that's what I need to do. I'm almost done with this part anyway.
Okay.
Pin it. There we go. You see that?
Yes, that's better.
So these are my numbers to 10. And students just lay them out on their desks. And what I do is I just walk around and I see who has the partners to 10. And once they're done, they put them away, and they have an individualized math booklet that they work on when others are completing their work. And as soon as they're fairly confident with this, I start putting two numbers on the board. So they will give me the partners to one number. And then once I walk around and I okay what they've done, then they do their partners to second number. And right now my class is already, it's pretty early in the year for this, but my class right now is using 10-sided dice. They roll them roll two dice, and they add the numbers together, and then everyone in their small group will make partners to a certain number and the number on the dice, and then and they see who can do it the fastest, the most quickly. And they're really enjoying that. And they will group by ability level. They'll find other kids who they know are about at their own speed, and they'll work together to form the partners. And they're, like I said, they're really enjoying it. One of my rules with that is they're not allowed to talk at all. So the whole classroom is just completely quiet. They're rolling the dice, they're finding their partners really quick. We do it for about 5 minutes, and then we move on. Okay, I will unpin this and I will go back to my slideshow presentation. Was there anything in the chat? Any questions?
No. Are you going to go back to the document camera again, though?
I will, yeah.
Okay.
Not right now. I'm going to the slideshow now.
Perfect. Okay, when you do, we'll make sure that we get everything.
Thank you. Yes, it can remind me. Now I have to see screen share. Oh, I am still sharing my screen. Okay. Right.
Perfect. We're looking at your PowerPoint.
Okay. All right. So these are my my numbers 1 to 10. And I continue with this until my students are, and this is the same stuff as I was talking about, but it's in the PowerPoint. So if you have to refer back to this or you want to read more about it, it's all in there. And once the numbers are really well established up to 20, then I will often give out 100 cards and or cards to 100. And they will say, oh, find 10 partners to 100, or find 5 partners to 55, or things like that. Every time we add two numbers, no matter how many digits, we are essentially adding to 20. Therefore, it's worth taking as long as students need to develop automaticity with partners to 20. So even if you're adding 7 digits, if you have one 7-digit number plus another 7-digit number, you're Your result will never be more than 20 because the biggest you can get is 19. The biggest answer you can get is 19. And then it's a place value issue after that with carrying or borrowing. I am very careful to use the language of partners instead of addition. There are certain students that enter my classroom with kind of the idea that subtraction is really difficult. And so with these partners, when I start teaching subtraction, I say, you're just taking one of the partners away. So if you have 10 minus 6, the other partner is 4. So that's the answer. So the, I don't know if you've seen the triangle flashcards that have the answer, the sum in one and then the two. Oh, I'm not going to have the right words for this, but they have like, so they have like 6 and 4 in two of the points of the triangle and then 10 in the other. So you can practice addition or subtraction with them. So we talk about that, how you're just really taking away one of the partners. And I have had a great deal of success in reaching curricular outcomes with my students. The Manitoba curriculum, I believe, is behind, I would say, or less stringent perhaps than the Quebec curriculum in some aspects. And so in grade 4, I'm expected to teach students to add and subtract to 10,000, and in grade 5 to 1 million. However, every year in grade 4, I will get students in my classroom who are not confident in adding and subtracting to 10. And I am generally, nearly all the time, I'm able to get them from that point of not adding to 10 all the way up to adding to 10,000 or a million to reach curricular outcomes by the end of the year. So it's this is just a different way of presenting it. And sometimes students who haven't learned these basic facts when being taught sequentially will find success when we use a different approach. Additional activities in addition, I use dice quite a bit. I have a bingo sheet and I start with 6-sided dice in line. So this is in line with the partners to 10. And I use a number of other activities as well. So I'm gonna switch to my camera. And I've got some, these are just the beginning sheets of what I do.
Hold on just a second, Faith. Yeah. So you're still showing your PowerPoint.
Yeah, I'm working on switching.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no problem. So switching, whoops. Not that. I think we'll have to just pin it. Okay. So now, can you see this well enough or
so we actually Christina in the chat suggested that we stop sharing your screen and then go to the screen share option again and see if we can get the document camera.
Does it show larger now or not?
No. So the screen share button is the one right next to the hand that's in the middle at the bottom of your meet.
Yeah, I've got it there. Tab.
Okay, Christina says it's perfect and fine now. So
okay, it's better now. All right. Okay, so this is something I actually started during COVID. The way our school set it up was that I was teaching 3 classes, but I was only teaching French reading and math. So I was able to teach the same math lesson 3 times in a day, and it just was like a fast forward on my math teaching. So one of the things I started doing was using the 100 chart as a visual representation of different math concepts. So this is counting by 1, starting at 0. They color the whole thing. They're like, whoa, that was easy. But just that idea that counting by 1s is a pattern as well. And then we count by 2s. So the students, we start counting at 0. So the students will color every second block. And again, in the past, I would have students who were highly spatial learners who would come up to me with a 100 chart and say, oh, I see the pattern now. I understand. So now I do this with all of my students. They will they'll color all the different patterns onto the 100 chart and count by threes, count by fours, and then we start counting by numbers as well. So they've got, so here, you know, they see the cool patterns of what happens here. And we talk about finding mistakes. What are some common mistakes we make when counting, when adding, you know, when counting by fours or adding four at a time? What is the pattern? Why is that the pattern? Just different things like that. So it's, seeing it visually represented can be really helpful for students, for all students, but especially students whose brains kind of look at the world a little bit of a different way. So now I have counting by two. So here they'll fill it out, 4, 6, 8. And what I'm not finished this booklet yet, but this year I'm also having them count by 20s. So after they've colored, this sheet and they're really solid on what are counting by twos, what are even numbers, then they'll count by 20. So it'll be 20, 40, 60, and then 200, 400, 600, 2000, 4000, 6000, etc. So they're counting by multiples of two and multiples of three and so on as well. I really like working with patterns of five. So I use Roman numerals a fair amount in my class because they regroup to five instead of our system that regroups to multiples of 10. And so I use counting by fives in a lot of different ways in my classroom. So here we're counting by five, starting with one. So then they see that pattern of how it moves down the row. And then we do counting, count by five starting at two. So we're not starting at zero anymore, we're starting at a different number. And they see how that, and then we talk about how really, you know, like here we're going 2 + 5 + 5, and that's 10. 7 + 5 + 5, that's 17. So I remember that's plus 10 equals 17. So we're talking about different patterns in math. And the thing about five is it's one hand. 10 is two hands. So if you have a student who's still kind of working to grasp the basics of addition and of patterns in math and of how to solve problems, then regrouping to a smaller number can be really helpful. And then I do fives counting at starting at three and so on. Okay. Go back to this. Do you see my PowerPoint again?
No, we're still on the document camera. Okay. So if you just stop the screen share and then start it and then do the screen share again and choose your PowerPoint, it should be good. Might be the fastest way to do it.
It's not liking me doing that for some reason. I'm not sure why. Well, there we go. I think that's it. Does that work?
Beautiful.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so that's the use of 100 charts for patterns in addition. So a lot of the addition and subtraction practice that my students do in class are questions that they create themselves. So they will work with whiteboards, they'll use playing cards, they'll use 10-sided dice to create addition questions for each other. And it's really neat to see them because I have students who are not as confident and they will choose partners who are kind of at their same level of confidence, and they will add two-digit numbers until they feel comfortable, and then they'll go to three-digit numbers. And then I have other students who will like create problems into the billions with, you know, four numbers that they have to add together and so on. So students really seem more motivated when they're creating their own problems, and they are also, they tend to increase the difficulty level to something that they can handle, or maybe even something that challenges them without me doing that. I do assess very regularly, and I have a basic assessment that I give of all the basic facts and a few other things we're working on. So it might be addition to 10,000, subtraction to 10,000, multiplication, division, and then also some telling time on an analog clock or place value or problem solving. So it's just a quick assessment that takes maybe just one or two questions for each. That doesn't take them very long to do, but I do it all through the year. So that way I can see the progression with a student. And I also always tell them that the tests are not me judging them. The tests are me finding out what I need to teach them, what it is that they do not yet understand. So it's an assessment of me, not of them, or an assessment for me, not for the report cards. For subtraction, start by counting backwards on a 100 chart. I have similar activities to the 100 charts I showed you for counting forward, where we count backwards and we color the patterns. I tend to start at 100 and moving backwards, so then the pattern's kind of a little different, because if you're starting at 100 and subtracting 3, all the time, then it's not going to be the same pattern as if you're starting at 0 and adding 3. Again, I talk about how subtraction is related to partners. And I use as many different strategies as I can to teach subtraction. Addition is something that they have learned fairly well. While I still have a few students who need additional help with addition, in general, they understand the concept. Subtraction has been more difficult for students, and they arrive with fewer positive feelings towards it in my classroom. So I use visualizing subtraction on a number line, subtracting the units, then the tens, then the hundreds in separate steps. When I did my music degree, we were taught to teach everything in at least 4 different ways. And so I try to find at least 4 or more different ways to teach each concept in a given month. So it's subtraction. My coworkers and I have worked together, and so we're always looking for new ways. We're always sharing new ways to teach subtraction in a meaningful way. Sorry about that. That's an announcement at my school. So we move on to multiplication, and I teach multiplication as area and perimeter. So I start with one block, and what I do is I hand out a book to my students and I give them 25 blocks, but we start with one. So I'm going to switch back and forth again here. What did I do last time that worked? We did something about...
You stopped the screen share and then...
tried it again.
Yeah.
There we go. Do you see it now?
Yes.
You can see it well?
Yes, this looks just like it was earlier.
Okay, great. All right, so this is what I use for area and perimeter. So my students each get 25 blocks like this. And I say you have one block. How many ways can you make a rectangle? Well, there's only one way to make a rectangle. So we draw our square. And then I say this is side A and this is side B. How many blocks on this side? Oh, it's one. How many blocks on that side? It's one. Great. Now our area is A times B. So we have 1 times 1 equals 1. Then our perimeter is 2 times A plus 2 times B, which is 2 times 1 plus 2 times 1 equals 2 plus 2 equals 4. And we move on. So now we have two blocks. There's one way to make a rectangle. I tell them, if you, they'll say, oh, well, I could put it like that. And I say, well, that's just, if you tilt your head, that's what you get. So it's basically the same thing. So there's, it has to be a unique rectangle each time. The 1 times 2 equals 2, and then so on with the perimeter. So as we're moving down, students will tell me they've memorized these multiplications, but they never understood what exactly it meant. And, you know, our teachers in the lower grades do a great job of explaining different multiplication in different ways and so on. But when they see it systematically represented like this, it just promotes a deeper understanding of what multiplication is. And it also really shows how multiplication is related to real life. Because when we isolate it and we say, you know, you have three apples in this basket, or three apples each in four baskets, well, when in your life do you ever have three apples in each of four baskets? It's not much of a real life problem. But when you have blocks and you have to create a square, then it's kind of easier for students to see how that might apply to, you know, flooring or other things in life where you're measuring things. So once I finish the first page, then I ask students to tell me which are the numbers for which we only had one rectangle and where the answer is not a square. So here, one is a square, so that doesn't work. Two is a rectangle, and there's only one solution, so they'll highlight that. Three is a rectangle, there's only one rectangle for three. Four, now we have two rectangles, that doesn't work. Five, we only have one way to make a rectangle. Seven, we only have one way to make a rectangle. And these are the prime numbers. So this is a definition of prime numbers that holds true all the way up to the highest levels of mathematics. If you're making a rectangle with whole number blocks, if you can only arrange them one way, that's a prime number right there. So my students become very confident in identifying prime numbers. And generally by the end of grade four, they will know their prime numbers up to 50 fairly confidently. And we work with prime numbers to 100. I also introduce the square right away. So here we see, I mean, I didn't draw it very nicely today. I do it better on the board. Here we see that it looks like a square. And I'll say, when you've got the same number times each other, you can write it as 1 squared and as 2 squared. Now, when I use centimeter squared in measurement, it makes sense to them because we've been talking about how when you write the little 2 up there, that means that both sides are the same. So centimeter squared just means 1 centimeter on that side, 1 centimeter on that side, it's a square, and that's a centimeter squared. So it's a concrete visual for them. And then in this booklet, for our curriculum here in Manitoba, in grade four, I am supposed to evaluate up to 5 times 5. What this booklet does, it doesn't just teach multiplication to 5 times 5, it teaches it to 25. So I start from the whole and move down to the parts. For 16, it would be 1 times 16, 2 times 8, 4 times 4. So I'll teach all of that right away. And because I'm starting from the answer, I use all the different possible results. Another thing that I do is, let's say I'm teaching 1 times 16. So I've got, well, here 1 times 16 equals 16. So now I tell them, if they're trying to figure out how many answers there are, if 16 is an even number, that we can double this one here. So then we've got 2 and we cut that one in half, and it's 2 times 8. If this is an even number, we can cut that in half and double this one, and then I've got 4 times 4. And then I've arrived at the same number, so I'm not going to have any other options. There are no other possibilities, and this will be 4 squared, and so on. So giving them strategies to identify whether they have fully factored a number in with the concrete blocks. I will say my students, most of my students who are with me for the first year will use the blocks to do this first workbook, but they will tend to go away from the blocks except for really challenging questions later on. So let's say they get like 71 and they're like, oh man, I don't know if this is a prime number or not. So they will, they have their 100 blocks by that point. So they have the numbers 1 to 100, which are squares. So they'll take out their 100 blocks and they'll put down 71 and they'll play with them to try to find a solution and figure out whether it's a prime number or whether there are other options for that. So my first booklet goes up to 25. My grade 5 level outcomes in Manitoba are up to 9 times 9. So my second booklet goes till the number 81. And my third booklet goes up to 100. And I have not gone beyond that, although I'm doing some, I've got some really advanced students this year. So we're doing some patterns, like a doubling of numbers up into the thousands and other patterns that are more complex than these basic facts. So yesterday when I was teaching in class, we were working on 12. I start the first page we do all together. Everyone does it together. But after that, if there are students who are really confident, they move at their own pace. Once they're finished the first booklet, they move on to the second and the third. The students who are not as confident will stay with me until they are confident. I'm always there to help them. If they're like, Madame, can you show me how to do 18? I'll work through it with them. So we had 12 blocks and we had our 3 rectangles. So 1 times 12, 2 times 6, and 3 times 4. And usually around this point, I start working with fractions. So I was like, I was asking them, can you tell me what 1/2 of 12 is? And then we talked about how we can also represent it as that, or no, equals 6. 1/2 of 12 is 6. How we can divide them up into 2 piles and find out that they're 6. And then I will start getting students who start noticing the pattern as well. So if 1/2 of 12 is 6, that means 1/6 of 12 is 2. So they'll start seeing how the partners we have learned in multiplication are useful when doing division, with doing fractions. So you're working with one partner or the other and you're putting them together. So I'll do fraction problems for all of the numbers that have a lot of different possibilities. So I'll do it for sure for 12. I usually do it for 18. Sometimes the students ask for a certain one, and we'll do that one as well. I'll talk a little bit about student engagement. In my classroom, if a student corrects me, they get a point. So that way, they're always thinking, is Madame doing it right or not? Does that make sense? They will correct me with little mistakes, you know, where I say the wrong thing or I make a little calculation error. I've actually become much more accurate through this because I make very few small calculation errors anymore because they're correcting me. However, they have to do it in a polite and appropriate manner. And if it's something like, oh, Madame, that is a feminine noun and not a masculine noun, they have to prove it with their dictionary that I was wrong, and usually I was not wrong. So they have to prove to me that I made the mistake, and they have to do it in such a way that does not disrupt the classroom. But when you give them the opportunity to correct you, and when you accept their ideas, and help them, let them help create materials, they can be really, really engaged in math class. And I usually get when math class starts, everyone's like, oh yay, it's math, it's so exciting. So it's nice to see that level of engagement. After we have gone to 25 with the blocks, we work on this section. So here they're highlighting all the multiple of twos. These are even numbers. Here we have the multiplication of two up to 24. So I don't go up to 10, I go up to the number I'm working on. And then we graph it. So I am working, I'm not happy with my graphing for the second booklet. This booklet, I'm happy with it for now. So 1 times 2 equals 2, and then 2 times 2 equals 4, and 3 times 2 equals 6. And they see very quickly that multiplication is a linear equation and that it is just going in a straight line all the way up. You can put your ruler there and then you can check, was my answer right? Yes, it was. So that is how you graph this multiplication. And then I do the same with the others in the booklet. So we have times 3, times 4, we graph them, and the fives. So as the multiplication goes higher, there are fewer and fewer equations because we're only ever working to 25 in this booklet. And then here I ask them to highlight all the numbers that are squares and write the equations of the square numbers. And then we graph the square numbers and they see that, I guess this is the equation, or this is the graph of x squared, and they see that it is not a straight line. So not everything is a straight line. This is a curvy line that goes up. And then they highlight all the prime numbers to 25. And they look back in their book and find for the squares and the primes, they'll look back if they need to. It was interesting because we had a kind of a complex problem to solve at the end of last year. And one of my grade 4 students said, oh, I need my area and perimeter book. And she went and looked at it and figured out what all the factors of that number were. And she got her answer that way. So it was sort of a reference for her. And then when we graph the prime numbers, it's all over the place. It's scattered. There's no pattern to it that we can see. Then we have counting by two, similar to my 100 chart that I did with addition before. Counting by two, start with zero, count by threes, count by fours, prime numbers and square numbers, just as a review of the book. And here we find the multiples of two, the multiples of three, and what they have in common, 2 and 5, and what they have in common, and 3 and 5, and what they have in common. In the higher level books, I still only really do 2, 3, and 5, because those are the first three prime numbers. And after that, it gets complicated. So we just collect these as an idea that it has to be the least common denominator, least common factor. I'm not sure how to say it. But anyway, it's the combination of these two. So if you're trying to find a common denominator, it will be one of these numbers here. That's a multiple of 3 and a multiple of 5 for later on in higher level math. And then we do this at the end. So 1 is a multiple of 1, and it's also a square number. I was doing check marks, and last year one of my students told me to write the number in, and it would be so much more clear, and she was right. So 2 is a multiple of 1. A multiple of 2, and it's also a prime number. And then 3 is a multiple of 1, of 3, and it is a prime number. So now if you write the numbers in on this chart, now you can look which are the multiples of 2, which are the multiples of 3, so you get your list instead of just a check mark, which I had never thought of and I thought was pretty cool. So that is my area and perimeter booklet. Okay, I will exit this. Are you seeing my PowerPoint again?
No, we're still looking at your doc camera.
Okay, can you see it now?
Yes, perfect.
Great.
You're getting good at this.
I am. You'd think after teaching online for how long I would know this stuff, but still learning. Okay, so this is a visual representation of multiplication, but really, if you think of it, I was really teaching them how to divide. I was not teaching them how to multiply. I was giving them the answer and then having them figure out what the equation was for that answer. And so if you think of later on in high school math, when they have to factor quadratics, these methods set up really strong foundations for succeeding in higher level math. It's not just memory, it's understanding, and it's seeing patterns and also developing automaticity. There's always, like, my prof at university right now makes small areas of algebra all the time. And so he's very happy to get correction from the students. But he makes small calculation or errors. And what I was finding is that my really strong math students would never get 100%. They'd be getting like 98 or 99%. And so that's another reason to teach them partners in this way to develop automaticity and avoid those small errors that we make that end up being a big problem later on. And so I teach prime numbers, different rectangles. We also play with our information a lot. So we'll we'll compare the perimeter of one rectangle to the other, try to make predictions which rectangle will have a larger perimeter and a smaller perimeter, things like that. So we're working with the numbers, not just filling out the worksheet and say this is it, but we're doing a lot of other activities with them. Division. Again, I try to teach division in as many different ways as possible. Students in general seem to have more anxiety about division than about the other operations, but I remind them that we've been doing division all along when we're working with our multiplication booklet. Playing with numbers. You may all be familiar with Ken puzzles, but I will demonstrate to you how to do a problem. My students love these, and I have a whole PowerPoint of them that I put up at the end of the day when you've got 2 minutes before the bell is ringing and you're kind of like, what are we going to do now? And we will do a Ken puzzle together. And again, my students with IEPs have done fantastic with these puzzles. It's just been a really positive experience for them. So we got that. Okay. Wait, you see that?
Yes.
It's kind of small though, right?
Yeah, but when I pin it, it's nice and big. Everything works fine.
Okay. All right, hopefully it stays down. It's getting small for me. I hope. Can you see that well enough, though?
Yeah. I mean, they're side by side, but everything seems... Yeah, it's still large enough.
Okay. So you go to Ken. I have the link in the PowerPoint. So we have Ken, and you have to choose the difficulty level. So I've chosen 3x3 only, addition and subtraction, and the easiest. So these are all, you can choose each of these. There's like 3x3, 4x4, 5x5, I think it was up to 9x9. And then you can either do just addition, addition, subtraction, or all four operations, and then from easiest to most challenging. So this is how I set it up for my students. I'll have the equations here. So say we can only enter numbers 1, 2, and 3 in each row and in each column. So what numbers from 1 to 3 equal 3? So what plus what equals 3, but you can only use 1, 2, 3 to put into there. So like 1 plus 2, 4, it's 1 plus 3, and 5, it's 2 plus 3. And then for 1, there's 2 possibilities. It's either 2 minus 1 or it's 3 minus 2. So these are all of the equations that they need to complete this question. So when there's just a 1 in the box, that's the answer. When you have a 5 plus, that means it's something plus something equals 5. For 4, it's something plus something equals 4. And the darkened lines are where you will insert the numbers, but you don't know in what order they'll be. So here I'm going to know that, I'll show one more thing. So when I do this in class, I will label these A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. And like that, my students will say I is 1. And then I would have a student telling me G is 3. And I'd say, oh, why is that? And they'll say, oh, because 4 is 1 plus 3, but I can't have a 1 there because it's already there. So we've got 3 here, 1 there. Someone will say A is 2. I'll say, how do you know that? And they'll say, because there's already 1 and 3 in that column, that has to be 2. And then this is 1, so then this is 3, 2, 3, and 2. So my students take turns giving answers, and they'll use the letter to say which number belongs in that spot. And I have another one for you here. So this is Ken, 4 times 4. So we've got 4. Now we're going to have our numbers from 1 to 4 to insert. And I have all 4 operations, and it's the easiest level. So I've got, again, my only possibility is 1 plus 3 equals 4, because I can't have 2 and 2, because then I have the same number twice in the same row. And then something minus something equals 2. Oh, I need 2 possibilities for that. Oh, I have 2. Okay, I did that. Right. Sorry. Mix up there. So 4 minus 2 and 3 minus 1. And then 4 minus 1 equals 3. So the students come up with these equations, and I'll say, who can name me an equation? And so they don't have to do them in order. They might do any of them. 2 times 3 and 3 times 4. And then here I should also have had 2 possibilities, and 2 divided by 1 equals 2. So now we go to the question. And again, I would label it A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P. So again, you can see how this is starting from the whole all the time and moving to the parts. So here I know that K is 2 because there's no operation after it. And I know that this is going to be 4 and 1. So 1, 2, so this has to be 3. And the only possibility for that one is 1. And here I know this is going to be 3 and 4. That is 2. So then here we'll have to see what happens. 3, 2, and so on. So this is going to be 4 and 1. So we've got 1, 1, 2, 4. This is going to have to be 3, which makes that 4. My students can explain their reasoning of this really well. I'm really impressed with them. One of these has to be 2, so that's not a 2, so this one has to be a 2, because both of our equations, our division equations, have a 2. So we don't know what that one is yet, but then we go 1, 2, 3, that is 4. This has to be 4 and 1, so that's 4 and 1. And 1, 3, and so on. So my students, when I'm calling on my students in class, when I started teaching classroom, I noticed that I would always kind of call on the same people. I had a couple of, that year I had like about 4 girls, and the rest were all boys, and I had a couple of really, really confident, assertive boys in the class. And I noticed I called on them the most. I had a few other boys who weren't as confident, and then some girls who were really, really, really quiet girls at that point. They changed throughout the year, but not at the beginning of the year. So I developed a strategy where I call on every student in my class an equal amount. If I have a student with an IEP, I might move the questions around a little so they get a bit of an easier question than someone else. But in general, everybody's expected to participate an equal amount. And that also really boosts participation in my class. So for a question like this, I'll go down the row and I'll say, pick one to answer. And they choose one they know, because I always kind of follow the same order. I follow the same order, but I start at a different place every time, so they know that their turn is coming up, and they can kind of think ahead what the question is. This doesn't work in the first 2 weeks of school or so, but after they're warmed up, they're used to my class, they know it's a safe place. At that point, everybody will answer the same number of questions when we're doing a class activity like this. So I turn the lights out. We have just this up on the screen. The kids are answering questions. It's a really calm time, and they explain how they came up with the answer that they came up with. Okay, I'm going to move right on to a couple of other things and not switch back to my PowerPoint. This is my place value exercise. This is just my basic level. I go a little bit higher up with it that way. So let's say we have 439. They have to write it in expanded form. They have to write it in words, the value of the digit in the hundreds place, the tens place, the ones place, round the number to the nearest 100 and to the nearest 10. And then I have mental math questions. So let's say my question this week, I would write +3. Here they would answer 439 plus 300. So in their head, they do like 739. They would just write the answer. Then I've got 439 plus 30. And this is just, I'm writing it to show you, but they do this all in their head. All they get is +3. So +30, so that'll be 469. And then I've got 439 plus 3. And so that'll be 442. So they will do, they'll do this booklet, and it just covers a lot of curricular outcomes. This year, we are also doing Roman numerals for whatever that number is. Once a student is really confident in this, we move on to four digits. And what I will generally do is I will have students who are doing three digits and students who are doing four digits. And later on, I move on to six digits once they're confident with four. So I might have students in three different booklets at the same time. So my students with the three-digit booklet will be working on, for this question, we'll have 193. So we're just really adding on the four. And then my students with the six-digit notebook might have 974,193. So I keep parts of the question the same so that there's continuity in what they're doing, and the answers are all kind of similar. So here again, write the number in expanded form, in words, the place value questions, round it off. And then I would have a mental math question for this too. It might be +4. So then the first one be +4,000. The next one they would calculate would be +400, +40, and +4. So at the beginning of the year, I start with addition. And then as we learn subtraction, I'll do subtraction. And I will try to, like, if we're talking about fives, then my question will be a +5 or a -5. If we're talking about patterns with five, whatever, it's sort of related to whatever we're doing in class. To expand this activity, I have also started doing a number of other things. For instance, we'll come up with, like, let's say this is our number. I'll say, so here you need to draw it. So they have to draw their how many thousands, how many hundreds, how many tens, and how many threes. So for anything that exceeds five, I always have them group it in fives. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then 4. And it's just a more clear representation if we group in fives, and it just really helps them. I'll take a little aside. Yesterday, one of my students who's really good at math but also has a big IEP for other subjects was having trouble. Are my booklets available? Whatever I'm presenting today, I will share with you guys if QPAT will send it to you. I am, my area and perimeter, I'm very comfortable with that one, so I'm sharing it. I am not as happy with the second level of that. So once I am happy with the state of my, that my booklets are in, I will happily share them with people. I do not know yet where they will reside. I don't intend to have my own math website. Sarah Malo has books on her math website. I'm talking to the University of Manitoba because I intend to do my master's degree there, and I'd be happy for it to be posted on their website in some fashion or other. But if you email me and tell me what you want to work on, you can. I would be very happy to share things. I actually don't spend a lot of time on booklets in my room. There's a lot of hands-on work, but I teach very individualized math programs. So I have actually created over 100 booklets, and these are just some of the more general ones. I have booklets that address very specific problems for students with very specific learning difficulties. So this is my drawing of a visual representation of the number. Then we say we have 4,193 cents. Oh, another thing is all my booklets are in French. So some of them are translated into English. But if I send it to you in French, you can probably figure it out. It's not that difficult. So I have this many cents. How much is that in dollars? Then I have 41.93. Sorry, this is in French. That would be 41.93. And then how do you represent this in money? So now the 3 doesn't work. We have to round it up to 5. So when we're counting out coins and stuff, so for that number, they'll do that. We do a lot of, this is like kind of crazy, but we do a lot of converting minutes into hours. So then we talk about like 60 minutes, 120 minutes is 2 hours, 180 minutes is 3 hours, 240 minutes is 4 hours, and so on. Like we make our little chart there. So then 4,193 minutes, how many days, how many hours, how many minutes would that be? And I have 493 centimeters is equal to how many meters? So then that would be 41.93 in English meters. And then the students have to give me something that makes sense with that number. So what could measure 41 meters? I have 493 milliliters is equal to 4.193 liters. And then what is something realistic that could have, that could contain that number of liters? So as many different possibilities of measure as possible, and many different ways of thinking of measure as possible. I do a lot of, so what is, plus 10 minus 10, plus 1 minus 1, plus 100 minus 100, and so on. So yeah, I have them all digitally. I have them all, I noticed something in the chat there. So yeah, so we just, for all the numbers, we'll do that. Is like, if it's an even number, cut it in half. If it's not, or even if it is, double the number, just whatever things we can think of to play with that number. So it's kind of like in lower elementary school, you have the number of the day. Here we have the number of the day, but we're just doing more complex operations with it. And we're thinking how this number relates to real life. How it's not just a number on a page, but it's something actual practical. Also, my time is almost up. But I'll just quickly show you one more activity. I have, this is in my handouts if I email them out. This is problem solving. I do the same problem 8 times with them with slight variations. And that repetition just gives them confidence and develops independence in answering questions. And then I also have This is a wonderful activity for spatial learners. So it's just any object, like the kids will bring in stuff from home. So they bring in a cereal box. So we have to draw I'm very precise. They have to draw very nice pictures, not like mine here. So let's say it's a cereal box measurement. They estimate it first. They tell me how many centimeters times how many centimeters do you think it will be? What do you think the volume will be? What is the shape, the name of the shape? I have a file with all of these. So yeah. And then we label them. So let's say this is 10 centimeters, 10 centimeters, and then this here is 5 centimeters. And then we do our calculations. So first we estimate what we think it'll be, and then we come to the, then we do our calculations, we get the real answer. And students become really great at figuring out what would the volume of this box be, what would the measurements be, and it's just, it's doing a lot of things at once, but again, not starting from tiny things building up, it's starting from the box itself and moving down into the parts. So that is quick fast forward at the end, but I think that's pretty much it.
That was pretty awesome. Love your ideas. Makes a lot of sense. Everything's good. I think I heard you say that you do have like all your files digitally available.
Yeah. I'm happy to send them out. If you email me, I could email you with the attachments. I also have a PDF version of my PowerPoint so people can read over it again.
That's fantastic. Thanks for sharing. And even I would think even your resources that are in French, like if you got those to me, I'd be like, okay, I can translate this to English. It'll be fine.
Yeah.
I got the framework and everything's good. So
on my PowerPoint, my work email and my home email are on the final presentation. So when you get the PowerPoint, if you ask me anything, I also have developed a whole system for teaching reading to children with dyslexia. So I'm very happy to share that as well. It is only in French, unfortunately, but it has proven very useful.
That's fantastic. I get
a lot of diversity in my class.
It sounds like it. And I loved at one point you mentioned you have individual lessons. You don't have like a lesson plan. You have a bunch of individual lessons for your students, and that's fantastic. Yeah. How are they going to get the PowerPoint?
What I do, like if you email me, can I email you like just a bunch of attachments and you forward it to people, or how does that work?
I am not sure.
Because when I've presented in the past, people have just emailed out my attachments to all participants at the end of a session.
No, and that sounds right. And I would assume it's probably going to happen. But just to be safe, can you just give us your email address right now? I'll put it in the chat. That way everyone has that. And at least everyone in this session is connected. And then if the conference mails out stuff otherwise, that's like an insurance.
Yeah, I think it's okay. Probably safest to email my work email. See that? Which is faith.lowen@lrsd.net.
And that's W-E-N?
Yeah, W-E-N. L-O-E-W-E-N, sorry.
No, not at all. And L-R-S-D?
Yeah, Louis Riel School Division.
.net. Awesome. Thank you so much. So I put that in the chat. So everybody's got it in the chat. This is recorded. So people can, when they get the recording, at least they can just watch this last little bit and be like, oh yeah, there it is.
And it will be 4 attachments. So I have 2 attachments with the handouts. One of my, I just finished the area and perimeter booklet this summer in English, and then a PDF of the PowerPoint.
Amazing. I'm going to stop the recording now and say thanks for all the great ideas and tips that you shared. And,